Vote Paisley number one, the only candidate worthy of your number one vote. Ian Paisley, this Thursday.
All the best. Thank God for your support. Hello there. Make a number one for Ian Paisley.
Have you ever watched Paisley? I've never seen anything like it anywhere in the world. He is a force of nature. He goes into a street, any street. It's presidential. A lot of people find him absolutely irresistible.
That was at the heart of Ian Paisley, his evangelical zeal. You know, getting converts and witnessing to the masses, that became what he did politically, because that's what he did in the church.
That they were under God's wrath.
Ian Paisley had a love for his God and a love for the souls of men and women. And you can see that so much in so much of what he did.
I haven't got armies. I haven't got money. I haven't got establishments, but I have God.
By the late 1970s, Ian Paisley was an influential figure, founder of his own Free Presbyterian Church and Democratic Unionist Party. He was determined that his values, both political and religious, would reshape Northern Ireland. Beginning in his own constituency, the North Antrim Bible Belt.
Ballymena, a town controlled by Dr. Paisley's party. Controlled too in a pretty dour fashion. Council workmen chain up the swings on Sundays so that children can't defile the Sabbath by enjoying themselves.
In this Ulster Bible Belt, everybody had a Victorian or an Edwardian view as to how the people should behave. The big joke at that time was that such was the fundamentalist hold on the Bible Belt that even the ducks had their legs chained up on a Sunday to stop them floating about. In many homes, the only book to be read on the Sabbath was the Bible.
And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children.
Some homes wouldn't even have television in them, simply because television was seen to be off the world, off the devil.
This is the Sabbath day as the righteous Protestant loyalist believes it should be celebrated if Carrickfergus is to find favour in the eyes of the Lord. And this is Sunday as it was yesterday. Roman Catholics and Protestants from the towns of Londonderry, Dungannon and Carrickfergus did battle together in chimpanzee costumes and giant postman's outfits in the bloodless arena of It's a Knockout.
Family-friendly game show It's a Knockout was a hugely popular BBC programme.
The town's 15 councillors, a clear majority, are staunch Protestant loyalists. And as one official told me, when they realised that if they were to have the honour and publicity of hosting It's a Knockout, they would have to connive at the breaking of the Sabbath, all hell broke loose.
And the law registered their protest against this proposal of the British Broadcasting Company to desecrate the Lord's Day.
As Dr. Paisley speaks, however, one begins to wonder how he can be so certain that God does not approve of It's a Knockout.
I am not the person that can decide what God thinks. This book decides. This is the word of God. God has spoken in his book. And as a Protestant, this is the infallible rule of faith and practice. And this book says, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
Ian Paisley bought into this idea, which he inherited, that this is a dangerous place, this world. This is not a world we were made for. This is a world that's lost its way. It's a sinful, broken, fractured world.
Have the foremost sinners in their neighborhood been born again? Have they made a vital impact against the dens of iniquity?
All we are called to do is to be persuaders of men. You don't have a right to tell people that they're going to hell, but we have that responsibility. And Dr. Paisley felt very strongly the burden of that responsibility.
Paisley's firebrand style was mirrored in his politics, but he was the only elected MP in his Democratic Unionist Party.
The party was looked down upon, and we were all the underdogs. In the early days, to identify yourself as a Paisleyite was akin to have some sort of political leprosy. We were articulating and representing that conservative, evangelical and unionist mindset that we felt was the bedrock of Ulster's existence, to stand the ground against all this immorality and the Republican threat.
I believe that the Ulster people today need to be awakened to the fact that the Irish Republican Army in our midst and all its supporters is a conspiracy against Protestantism. And their aim and objective, make no mistake about it, is to establish an all-Ireland republic dominated by the Roman Catholic hierarchy.
In a country that was in the midst of the Troubles, Paisley's uncompromising stance was attracting more people to his hardline politics. One of them was an estate agent called Peter Robinson.
The attitudes of the Democratic Unionist Party are inextricably bound up with the church. Robinson himself is deeply religious. He doesn't smoke and he doesn't drink.
I hope I'm more than being religious. I'm saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. That makes me a Christian. God has laid down clearly in his word what man should do and the pattern that man should follow. I try to follow that pattern.
I happen to be a reasonably young Ulster man who has watched friend after friend die. That might make me angry, and it might make me calculate where this province should go.
Ian Paisley had identified that Peter Robinson had a lot of ability. He had identified he was an organiser. Peter Robinson learned a lot from the way Ian Paisley operated.
Peter was ambitious, and that's not a criticism of him. It's an observation. I mean, it was obvious to me that he was keen to build a base and to get elected.
Robinson would be a strong asset to the House of Paisley, which previously had largely been a family affair, managed by Ian Paisley's wife, Eileen.
I always felt she was the brains of the outfit. She was the political thinker of the family.
Go and start at the top door and knock. Just knock once, don't knock the door in. Just knock once and then...
Even the youngest children were getting involved. Twins Kyle and Ian Jr.
Go to the next door, all right? Can I get a drop of light pen?
Let's not forget that Eileen was in politics long before Ian won his seat in Banside.
People can't rule a country, can't be in a government if they're out to destroy it.
It's true.
During the war, they wouldn't have brought Hitler or Goebbels or Rommel.
If Eileen developed a political career, I have absolutely no doubt that Eileen Paisley would have been the Margaret Thatcher of Northern Ireland.
What's he like at home? He's got a great reputation for having plenty to say outside. Is he the same inside?
Well, he really is rather quiet at home. And, of course, when he has to say things, he says them. But he's not a loud noisy man about the house at all.
The Paisley brand was the family unit. It was that strength that no matter what challenge you faced in life, the family was always there to support you.
A dynasty built on the two pillars of church and politics was being established, standing firm to uphold their conservative values at a time of great social change.
I was brought up in a Christian home. I didn't smoke. I didn't drink. I didn't do drugs. I needed a rebellion. And music for me was a rebellion. I got my guitar and I started listening to heavy metal. I actually had long hair in those days. And I remember someone challenging me that I was the spawn of Satan because I was playing heavy metal. It was like a breath of fresh air, such freedom.
Young people were challenging traditional attitudes and embracing new liberal freedoms.
Conservatism was a big bug for me because it was very judgmental.
Being queer here was probably very different than it was anywhere else in the world. You were not only navigating homophobia, you were navigating the state in terms of the way the war was here at the time.
Homosexuality. Do you know what?
This is Ireland. We don't talk about corruption and doubt like that. That's all right for England, but not for Ireland.
No, it wouldn't offend me.
It would offend me in public.
Yeah.
But if they want to do what they want to do in private, that's entirely up to themselves.
I think people should listen to what God has to say about it. God describes us as sodomy, and that's why destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah.
Northern Ireland's conservatism was coming under some challenge. The whole moral field was changing, and we felt we had to stand our ground because we just felt that other forms of sexuality shouldn't be countenanced.
When a movement was launched by activist Jeff Dudgeon, campaigning to decriminalise male homosexuality, Paisley felt compelled to act.
What influences do you feel it is that have prevented the government from bringing Northern Ireland into line on this subject?
Well, they state it's the concern of the evangelical Protestant section and the Roman Catholic hierarchy.
Ian Paisley was called to be an agent of God in this place to protect the values of God that are here. I might think of Save Ulster from Sodomy. He believed that that was inconsistent with God's plan for this place. So he wanted to maintain the criminalisation of homosexuality as an expression of that.
Ian Paisley created a controversial counter-campaign to Dudgeon, Save Ulster from Sodomy, petitioning to keep sex between consenting adult men illegal.
Well, the goal was to keep sodomy as an illegal action. The Bible teaches us in Leviticus that it is an abomination for a man to lie with another man.
The stand of my party is very well known on this issue, and I think the election results show that on this issue the vast majority of people in Northern Ireland are with me.
The language that was used was quite biblical in the most part, because most of it was coming from people who were maybe fundamentalist Christians. It wasn't just sodomy. So it was things like abomination, perversion. And that's what Paisley and the Save Ulster from Sodomy type attitude created. It gave a wider permission, I think, in society to treat gay people dreadfully.
Come here tonight to protest against the gay sweatshop production of Iceberg.
Have you seen the show?
No, we haven't seen the show.
Okay. Do you intend to see the show?
No, I don't intend to go to the show.
What are you worried about?
Because it's a propaganda ploy by Northern Ireland Gay Rights Association as to make homosexuality as an accepted normal standard of morality in Northern Ireland.
It takes so much energy to live in a world that tells you all the time that you are wrong and bad and that they hate you. And then on top of that, you're being told that you were going to go to hell once you died. You know, I mean, that stuff gets to you.
An outside body who is not committed to the moral values that the people of Northern Ireland are committed to is prepared to say you will legislate perversion and immorality.
The gay rights campaign eventually succeeded, and homosexuality was decriminalised in Northern Ireland nearly 15 years after England and Wales.
Paisley knew that those kinds of campaigns would be rejected by more people than they would attract. But that was fine, because as long as you attract some, you keep growing.
Paisley lost this battle, but his evangelical zeal wasn't dampened.
Paisley toured his Westminster constituency of North Antrim to rally the faithful.
Got your voting done. One,
not
two,
yet.
Three,
not
four,
yet.
Five, six, seven.
No, no, no.
Oh, all good children go to heaven.
Paisley's constituency is like the man, vast, rolling, deeply religious and conservative.
Well, you know what to do.
Oh, yes.
Get that one vote in first,
yes.
Steve.
Oh,
the last shall be first, it's scriptural. You never get tired walking backwards.
The 1979 general election was Paisley's opportunity to prove his critics wrong. He was more than a one-man band. He was the leader of a movement.
The young man by Dr. Paisley's side is the candidate of the Democratic Unionist Party. Peter Robinson stands for the return of a Protestant-dominated local government, the restoration of capital punishment, and a sealing of the border with the Irish Republic.
To keep the Paisley brand expanding, he needed more of his loyal deputies to get elected to Westminster. But to do this, his party would need to take votes from the long-established Ulster Unionist Party.
It wasn't quite clear where he was going, because it still looked in 1979 as if the Ulster Unionist Party were the power in the land. Every other seat that was a Unionist seat was an Ulster Unionist seat, and they were the establishment.
With the ongoing possibility of a return to power sharing between Unionists and Nationalists, the DUP took a firm stance.
A lot of people will find it very hard to understand what it is that divides you and the official Unionists and the Unionist Party of Northern Ireland, all of whom are running against each other in this constituency.
Well, in this constituency, there is only one non-power-sharing candidate, and that is myself. All the other candidates have at one time or the other supported power-sharing of one type or the other.
I think, Mr. Chairman, at this stage, you should take over the meeting.
Peter was a very good politician. He had a lot of political acumen. He was a good tactician.
They intend to extend the beach.
I worked as election agent in 79 for Peter Robinson. The strategy was the authentic true voice of unionism, as it were. The reliable, the one who won't let you down.
There's always a chance that anyone can win. That's the whole point of elections. I believe, and indeed the canvass to date has proved it, that there is a strong unionist vote behind me, and I believe that I'll be returned.
Well, in our Belfast studio, he's just come in hot with his new script in his hand.
It was a hard-fought campaign.
It was the breakthrough election.
Well, so far as Northern Ireland goes, the most sensational result so far here has been in Belfast, where the Reverend Ian Paisley's Democratic Unionist Party has gained the seat from the official Unionists.
Winning the seat by a margin of 60 votes, Robinson defeated his Ulster Unionist competitor, one of three MPs now elected from Paisley's party.
What do you attribute the success of Ian Paisley?
The Democratic Unionist Party does tend to run a much more militant policy, and of course it has been attacking the official Unionist Party very considerably in this election. It's been adopting the slogan, "This is the Unionist Party you can trust."
That was a sign that the party had potential within the Unionist community. It certainly was a landmark that Peter Robinson was going into the House of Commons. The person who perhaps was celebrating most was Ian Paisley. Proved he wasn't a one-man band, and there was a future for the DUP.
Yeah.
Ian Paisley had even more cause for celebration, as the election saw the appointment of a new UK Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher.
Margaret Thatcher would seem to be, she was for the Union. She seemed probably the answer to unionism's prayers. You know, the Iron Lady, somebody who was going to take a tough stand.
With the support of all those who believe in the Union, we'll continue to uphold the clear and democratically expressed wish of the majority of Ulster people to remain citizens of the United Kingdom.
There we are. Now, it was given to me in Fork Hill. Don't you think it looks very nice?
Mrs. Thatcher said, you don't want words, you want action. And I mean to have action. She also said that she saw eye to eye with us in our security aims, if not altogether in security methods.
Paisley saw Thatcher as an ally, both in her unionist views and in her desire to defeat the IRA.
These men deny democracy everywhere. They seek power for themselves.
As Republican prisoners went on hunger strike demanding political status, her stance only toughened.
They seek to work on the most basic of human emotions, pity, as a means of creating tension and stoking the fires of bitterness and hatred.
10 hunger strikers died, and violence on the streets intensified. For many people, Belfast city centre had become a no-go area.
Coming into your teenage years, there wasn't much to do. The city centre closed after dark. It literally closed because they had security gates all over the place. But then punk came along. My bestie gave me a copy of 45 single of God Save the Queen, which had been banned on Radio 1. I just went, that's for me. A lot of people back then thought we were the devil incarnate. It was a very dark time, but there was that kind of flashes of light, flashes of life as elsewhere. We were uniting together, you know, organically, Protestants and Catholics and the atheists and whatnot. We were a million miles away from evangelicalism and free Presbyterianism, but that didn't stop some of the evangelicals trying to save your soul.
God's word says prepare to meet.
The ones that were shouting through megaphones and bashing Bibles, it was all about, you're all going to die, you're all going to hell.
Now, God's word says today, if you hear his voice.
Ulster's on the road to perdition, and the troubles were a result of sin.
When it is time. And not in eternity. Oh, I thank and praise.
Numerous times we'd be at the fountain in Cornmarket, approached not just by the kind of roaring preachers, even by more softer, respectable types, softly spoken and terribly nice. But they came down to save our souls, and one of them just happened to be Rhonda Paisley.
The second of Ian Paisley's five children, Rhonda, had started to play an active role in her father's church, attempting to convert the youth of Belfast.
The reason why we did pay attention to her was because she was who she was. I mean, she introduced herself as Rhonda Paisley, and someone says, do you know who she is? It's Paisley's daughter. What? She's really nice. She was very charming. And she could communicate, I'll give her that. She had great communication skills with us. She invited us up for tea. And with tea and sandwiches, it was a big spread, I recall. We knew we weren't going to get any booze, though. We resigned to our fate that afternoon that it was going to be tea. We were in one room talking to Rhonda, and the big man came in, and it's the first time I'd seen him in the flesh. I didn't think he was that large at all. I really... That was the thing that struck me. And then he boomed in, he goes, all right, lads, you're enjoying your tea. But he was very nice.
It was completely warm and welcoming, you know, and there seemed to be a dichotomy between the politician and the person.
By 1985, more than 2,500 people had been killed as a result of the Troubles.
Although it's now 3.5 hours since the double bomb explosion which killed the soldiers, the army still can't allow anyone.
The first murderer today appears to have been deliberately sectarian. As tonight's grim figures bear out, terrorists on both sides of the sectarian divide aren't short of guns and bullets.
In Belfast, loyalist paramilitaries are suspected of shooting a milkman making his regular delivery to this newsagent.
Amid the continuing violence, Margaret Thatcher entered into discussions with her Irish counterpart, Taoiseach Garrett Fitzgerald.
The moderate unionists and the moderate nationalists in the north were beginning to lose any support because nothing was happening. And the Taoiseach said to her, if we don't do something, it's going to leave the two extremes managing to hold both you and me as hostages. The only way that we can actually manage to build anything without being taken hostage by our extremists on either side is to have an agreement whereby we consult one another, we talk to one another, and we go forward together.
With Tom King, Thatcher's Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, there was a plan in place.
I think it was July. We had this paper in Cabinet on the proposals for a new agreement between the British government and the Irish government.
The 6 o'clock news from the BBC with Sue Lawley and Nicholas Witchell.
At 2 o'clock this afternoon at Hillsborough Castle, just outside Belfast, the Prime Ministers of Britain and Ireland signed an agreement which gives the Republic a formal say in the affairs of Northern Ireland.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Fitzgerald and I have today signed a serious and solemn agreement which signifies the way ahead in relations between our two countries and towards peace and reconciliation in Northern Ireland.
The Anglo-Irish Agreement, which gave the Irish government a role in Northern Ireland, was reached without consultation with the Unionists.
The demonstration led by Ian Paisley, we could hear in the great big drawing room in Hillsborough where we had the signing of the agreement. You could hear the hammering on the gates outside.
That was a shock to see our MPs being handed a piece of paper by a journalist through the railings at Hillsborough to tell them what had been agreed.
So let us make it clear, we have seen the document, and the document is worse than we ever thought it would be.
The Anglo-Irish Agreement was an attempt to give the nationalist community a recognition, if you like, and they were objecting to it because, as they said, it was the way to a united Ireland.
I think they felt betrayed. They didn't believe it would happen, and then it did happen. And most of all, they didn't believe Maggie Thatcher would be the person who would deliver it. And it meant that the relationship between Margaret Thatcher and the Unionists after that was never the same.
Protesters were waiting at the City Hall for Mr. King's arrival. At first, there were only about 20 of them, but a car was placed across the entrance, blocking access to the building. Police decided to get him in at the side, but the demonstrators followed, and Mr. King was jostled as he got out of his car.
I don't believe it's sane and prudent for Mr. King to be seen anywhere in Northern Ireland. And the more he's seen, the more he is inciting people. Let him go and do his own thing.
He came out the way he went in, amid similar scenes.
No! 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 No!
One chap sort of made a lunge at me, and a couple of police got hold of him. It all happened so fast. We did have to be careful where we went. There's no question about it.
A mass rally in Belfast city centre was organised to protest against the agreement.
There was a colossal crowd had arranged. Probably it would have been the biggest rally I would ever personally have attended.
The turnout in the city hall, I've never seen the likes of. It's almost as if the unionist community as a whole had come to Belfast. It was a remarkable sight. But what happened on the stage that day was very important.
Due to address the crowd was Ian Paisley and the leader of his Ulster unionist rivals, Jim Molyneux.
Jim was a very quiet person, but that didn't get you onto the TV at tea time.
Ladies and gentlemen. I can't hear. I wonder, could the stewards on either side ensure that the bands would stop playing? That would enable the rest of you to hear.
Paisley had the opportunity to steal the limelight.
Nobody remembers. You know, they don't show pictures of Jim's speech. They always show Dr. Paisley's speech.
Here do the terrorists return to for sanctuary to the Irish Republic. And yet Mrs. Thatcher tells us that that republic must have some say in our province.
He captured the moment. And in many ways, Ian Paisley became the voice of unionism that day. All the other unionist MPs were there, but it was Ian Paisley's moment. There was no question about that. He tapped into anger about that Anglo-Irish agreement.
We say never, 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 never.
It was one of those chilling moments when you felt the hairs in the back of your head and you knew that you were part of something that was history. It's one of those pivotal moments in the history of Northern Ireland, and there have been many of them, but in terms of how you felt on that day, it was it certainly is at the top of the league.
British we are, and British we will remain!
Certain points in our history, moments arise for him, like the Anglo-Irish agreement, where it's very easy for him to point to that threat and to trigger a kind of loyalist or unionist paranoia.
In just 15 years, Ian Paisley had gone from the fringes to the forefront of Northern Irish politics. And election to the European Parliament had boosted his contentious profile in Europe.
He referred routinely in the 1970s and 80s to the European Union being a papish conspiracy. It was the whore of Rome. The European Union was the whore of Rome.
The Lord save us from ever conforming our laws to the nations of Europe. That would be a tragedy where you have prostitution run as a business under government licenses, where you have very relaxed licensing laws as well. The Lord deliver us from ever conforming to European standards.
And then when people asked him, why are you, well, you have to keep an eye on what the whore's doing.
Self-assured in the international arena, Paisley brazenly made his presence felt.
Police were having to restrain a group of militant Protestants who were booing, shouting and throwing missiles. Ian Paisley was singing a hymn while his supporters were scuffling with the police.
The Reverend Ian Paisley tried to disrupt a speech by the Pope this morning to the European Parliament in Strasbourg.
Dr. Paisley had
very strong beliefs, as indeed many of us do, that the Pope is the Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition. And that just could not be gone without a protest.
The Pope remained calm, clearly anticipating the heckler in the back row. Mr. Paisley quoted a 16th century anti-papist slogan as furious Euro MPs threw papers at him in disgust, snatching the poster.
I'd always admired the stand of the man, but that really rose even higher on that occasion. It was a very courageous thing to do and very expressive of what he believed.
There was another poster in his pocket for each one snatched away.
Ian Paisley wasn't afraid of a stunt. Got attention, and it got him noticed. I don't think it did Ian Paisley any damage politically.
Back in Belfast, the House of Paisley was flourishing.
Rhonda Paisley is a candidate for her father Ian's Democratic Unionist Party. She admits that if elected, she'll enter local politics in the bitterest atmosphere there's ever been.
I'm sure it'll not be too pleasing because I can't see that anyone who's lived in Northern Ireland and knows the murder which the IRA have carried out, I don't see how it can be a very pleasing thing to have to sit opposite someone who agrees with that kind of behaviour.
There are some names which take on almost a magical quality. Paisley's name represented a brand, represented a worldview.
Twins Ian and Kyle were forging their own characters in one of Northern Ireland's most prominent families.
It must have been very difficult when you went to school and you said your surname was Paisley. Because they were sons of the nonce, you probably had a perception of them that certainly, in Ian's case anyway, didn't always translate to be maybe what you would have expected it to be. You would have probably had someone who was a bit more quiet or reserved, and those are not two characteristics that you could attribute to him.
The boys followed in their father's footsteps, Kyle into the church and Ian Jr. into politics.
I got to know Ian very well at university, and it was clear he was going to go into politics. Yeah. When he was at Queen's, he was very active in the DUP's association, and already he was courting journalists, albeit student journalists at the time, and I thought he'd definitely be a future politician. I just think he liked engaging with the public. He liked debating at Queen's, I remember that. And he's the sort of person that would be a public figure, you knew that. I suppose he, in a way, can't escape it with that name. But he kind of embraced it from very early on.
He's been described as a fiery bigot by many. By others, he's loved as a saint. To me, he's warm, loving, kind and generous. And I count it an honour to welcome my father, the big man himself, Ian Paisley.
Yeah! Ian Paisley's celebrity allowed him to denounce the Irish Republic in one breath and appear on a Dublin chat show in the next.
I never thought I'd see the day, Dad, when you and me would be sitting in Dublin having a chat.
Yes. I was just thinking that the first time I came to Dublin was 37 years ago, and I preached in O'Connell Street at an open-air meeting. They didn't like what I said, so I said to the man who was conducting the meeting, "What do we do now?" He says, "You run for it, or you might be in the Liffey." So I ran for it.
A short while ago, the elected members of Sinn Féin left the City Hall, cheered on by their supporters.
But in Northern Ireland, Sinn Féin, the political wing of the IRA, was developing an electoral strategy.
So Sinn Féin goes through a lot of changes. The hunger strikes and long cash, and the development of Sinn Féin as a growing political party.
We have no intention of ceasing to be successful. On the contrary, we intend to be successful again and again and again.
To Ian Paisley, they were the enemy.
and then Ian Paisley's famous sledgehammer portrait that they were out to smash Sinn Féin. And this is against the background of sledgehammers being used to break down people's doors.
Let's face up to it. Let's not bluff ourselves. We're on the verge of civil war.
Once the Ulster Protestant feels that he is morally justified in fighting, then he will fight.
We believed that the maintenance of Northern Ireland was worth fighting for.
Once he feels that he's justified in fighting the army and fighting the police, then there's not an army in Europe, and there's certainly not an army in Great Britain or a police force that will be able to stand against the weight of united Protestant resistance to the sellout to our heritage.
It became evidence that we're going to be sold out if we don't do something. There was a readiness to indicate afresh, we'll fight.
Escalating his militant unionism, Paisley endorsed a new paramilitary-styled organisation, the Ulster Resistance. To many, he was condoning terrorism.
The latest phase of the unionist campaign began this week with the formation of yet another paramilitary-style force at a private religious service in Belfast.
The Protestants feared a united Ireland and what it would mean, and they were prepared to take whatever measures necessary.
So I make a personal appeal to you, as a political leader in this province, I intend to give this movement of Ulster resistance my undivided support. I will give it whatever political cover it needs.
Paisley always said that he never encouraged anyone to engage in violence and that he wanted peace with justice. And he was against terrorism, whether it was loyalist terrorism or Republican terrorism. He was always consistently saying those things. But then on the other hand, he marches with the Ulster Resistance. He wears a beret. Some people have licensed legal weapons around him. He's seen engaging with paramilitary leaders. This is at best a complex and confusing mix of messages.
This is not a battle for money, or it's not a battle for anything, but the right to remain what we are. And that goes right down to our hearts and homes. It goes right into the inner fibre of our being, and even the Iron Lady would be broken on that rock.
You would fight?
Yes.
With weapons?
Yeah, with everything.
The terrorist hall was put on display by the police this afternoon. They described it as a very important find.
2 years after the formation of the Ulster Resistance, a cache of weapons was discovered, along with items related to the group. Ian Paisley was quick to distance himself and diminish his involvement.
Accepting that these men are innocent until proved guilty, your critics might say that if they have committed any crimes, they have done so as a result of joining an organisation that you set up.
I didn't set up the Ulster Resistance. That is untrue. The Ulster Resistance was set up by the leadership of Ulster Resistance.
But you associated yourself with it.
What I said, just a minute or two, I'm not denying that. Don't get excited, my friend. I'm not denying that. I'm saying I promised that I would give them political cover if they went the road that they promised to go. But they have taken another direction, and along that road I'll not be going.
But Paisley was becoming a man out of touch. If the 1970s and 80s had seen steady social change, the 90s saw a shift in the political landscape.
Most people want to get on with their lives, and they don't have any great fixation of hostility towards their neighbours.
Republicans celebrate in Belfast as the IRA says a quarter of a century of violence will end completely at midnight.
The end of the IRA's campaign was quickly followed by a Loyalist ceasefire.
The combined Loyalist military command will universally cease all operational hostilities as from 12 midnight on Thursday, the 13th of October, 1994.
Peace talks in Northern Ireland were beginning to gain traction, but were soon threatened by tensions over Orange Order marching routes.
This was the fifth time the Orange Men had tried this year to march the route.
Nationalist opposition to the marches was strongest in County Armagh, the birthplace of the Orange Order and Ian Paisley.
The marching was really a symbol of the domination of the unionist community over the nationalist community. And it was done deliberately in a lot of areas in Northern Ireland, but Portadown was particularly bad because it was such a small nationalist community.
People here don't question the Orange Order's right to march, just not in their backyard.
Portadown is completely segregated, and everybody knows that this is, for the time being, the nationalist quarter.
It was again that old sense of nationalism determining where people could exercise their right to walk on the Queen's Highway, and that something that had happened for years without there being any agitation, all of a sudden it was an orchestrated opposition to a peaceful parade, a Sunday service in a country church outside Portadown.
As dusk fell yesterday, the Orange demonstrators were preparing for a long standoff after the police had refused to allow their church parade to march along the Drumcree Road onto the mainly nationalist Garvaghy Road. The DUP leader Ian Paisley was among the unionist politicians who gathered at the scene to discuss a compromise with senior RUC officers.
For Ian Paisley, the impasse was an opportunity to once again vie to lead the unionist charge.
You may take on other people in your travels, but you can't take on Ulster Parliament!
Paisley was always in the background, egging on the Loyalists and the Orange Order, you know, not to give in.
If we don't win this battle, all is lost. So it's a matter of life or death. It's a matter of Ulster or the Irish Republic.
After 3 days, a compromise was reached. Paisley and the Orange Men could march along the traditional route, but without music.
And so nearly 48 hours after the standoff began, the Orange Men of Portadown are finally on the march to Garvaghy Road.
I actually remember women crying down at the bottom of the Garvaghy Road because they felt they were just crushed, you know, that there was no one ever going to support them, you know. And Paisley was at the back of all that, pushing against any change.
For Paisley, this was a victory, but one he reluctantly had to share with the soon-to-be Ulster Unionist leader, David Trimble.
David Trimble and Ian Paisley walked together with their arms held up. There were two reasons for that. From the Paisley's point of view, he wanted to show he was the man. From David Trimble's point of view, he wanted to prove he was the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party.
Well, we're delighted to be back down the traditional route, as we expect to be again.
Yeah! I think Ian would have preferred, probably, if David wasn't there, and he came down the road on his own. But what could he do?
1995 was the beginning of a dispute that would rumble on every July for 5 years.
It
Drumcree sadly became more sinister. It became more toxic. It became an environment where it wasn't about enthusiasm. That sense of achievement was lost by all that subsequently unfolded in relation to what became the history of Drumcree.
Today's rallies are the latest in a succession of initiatives in support of peace.
A new round of peace talks was initiated by newly appointed British and Irish leaders, Tony Blair and Bertie Ahern, creating a growing optimism in Northern Ireland.
What opinion survey after opinion survey showed us was that people were tired of war. They were tired of the inch-by-inch negotiations that had followed the IRA ceasefire. They wanted, above all, both peace and stability.
Those previously caught up in loyalist paramilitary violence were tired of fighting and created their own political parties.
We just wanted this conflict to end. We wanted our children to have normal lives the way the kids in Scotland, England and Wales were having, and to be able to go out and not worry about every time your kids go out to go to a nightclub or go into town and then you hear a bomb going off. I went through it, and a lot of families have went through it, loyalist, Republican, nationalist, Protestant. We've all went through this here.
But this sentiment of political compromise wasn't in Paisley's script. Refusing to negotiate in talks involving Sinn Féin, Paisley was saying no.
Ian Paisley, why is this election so important in your view?
Because the decision of the Ulster people must now be registered to stop the betrayal of the British government and the conspiracy that has been hatched to destroy Northern Ireland as an integral part of the United Kingdom. This is a battle for our destiny.
Vote for the Unionist Party. You can trust.
As Ian Paisley campaigned against the talks, another Paisley entered the arena to help.
All right, good to see you.
Canvassing in North Antrim is not a difficult task for Ian Paisley Jr. It's a DUP stronghold. At 29, he's seen as being primed to eventually take over his father's role.
I think Ian Paisley had ambitions for his son. Maybe he saw Ian Paisley Jr.'s eventual successor.
I'll just start arguing with them, just bid them good night and go off.
I think part of the dynasty syndrome that may have been into Ian Paisley's thought processes, he might have hoped that ultimately he'd be succeeded by his son, Ian Jr. I suspect his son thought that too.
Dividing the Unionist support for a deal, Ian Paisley denounced those involved in the talks, including the leader of his Ulster Unionist rivals, David Trimble.
The time has come when we must indict David Trimble, call him to the bar of public trial, and remove him forever from his office.
By the time David became leader, he was determined to make changes. He was convinced that unionism had to be more strategic and long-term thinking. But he was under constant attack from Ian and from within his own party. I think if Ian had stayed in and not exploited the situation, I think unionism would have got a far better deal.
Staying out of the talks today, but keeping a close eye on them, was the DUP. Ian Paisley believes the Ulster Unionists are wasting their time.
They said they wouldn't sit down at a table and discuss the union. Now they've suddenly reversed that. Why have they reversed that? Because of the pressures put on them by the British government.
The DUP were outside the tent pissing in instead of inside the tent pissing out. We were classified as traitors because we were sitting down with Sinn Féin and the IRA and trying to formulate a way forward. To be honest with you, I question myself sometimes around it, but we had no other alternative.
Ian Paisley's position before the agreement was such that we knew it was inevitable that he was going to oppose it. He had experience of bringing down such an agreement with the loyalist community in 74. I am sure that he thought he could do the same again in 1998.
With the two prime ministers and eight parties locked in round-the-clock discussions and a midnight deadline looming, the potential was always there for an extraordinary night. So it proved.
With the talks reaching their climax, Ian Paisley arrived at Stormont in a last-ditch attempt to bring the whole process down.
And we were warned by the police, you know, you need to be careful about yourselves here because there's a lot of these guys in the grounds and we think they'll get here.
We've got here, I asked, that you'd get up here as far as the monument. Now we've done that.
Paisley turned up and held a news conference. And actually, it was the loyalists who hackled him mercilessly.
Ian, where are you going to take us?
The Grand Old to New York, Mark Woman, Mark Two.
Not to Dublin anyway.
Well, I wish you would walk out.
They were turning on him quite in a feral way, accusing him of being the Grand Old Duke of York, unleashing forces that then he ran away from, you know, serious accusations.
This is a press conference, and you're not press men. You belong to parties that are opposed to my party. Well, just shut up. Just shut up.
People that shut up are gone.
You'll have your press conference later.
You have your own press conference with your buddy Jerry Adams. Have it, and you'll be very welcome to it. Let me say to you tonight.
Not one of you can give out a number.
The DUP weren't used to being heckled. Glad we've done that because too many times did we listen to rhetoric and just accepted it and moved on. This time we were challenging the rhetoric. We're doing your dirty work no longer.
For the first time in my life when I see Paisley, I saw someone who looked vulnerable. I thought, he's on the defensive here and this crowd are turning on him. It marked a change in unionist loyalist politics.
One of you can give out a number. Let me call yourself loyalist.
And you were sort of asking, really, is that the end of Ian Paisley?